Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our webinar on working with COVID-19 in the construction industry. I'm Fraser May. I'm the communications advisor, just manager these days for Civil Contractors New Zealand. And just wait a couple of minutes for people to arrive in the room. And I'm also conscious that we have scheduled the webinar for the same time as a government announcement on COVID-19. So sorry to those of you who are attending that, wanted to attend that. We'll step and get you updated as we go. With me today, I have a few guest speakers, one of which is Francois Barton from Business Leaders Health and Safety Forum. Hi, Francois, and you're coming to us from Dunedin Airport, is that right?
That's it, on transit to Invercargill.
Yeah, nice. Oh, well, how's the weather down there today?
Characteristically fine, yeah, as it always is in the deep south.
Yeah, so we've got James Warren with us as well. So he's a partner at Dentons, Kensington, Swan, and he's going to give us a lowdown on the law today. How are you going, James?
Very well. Hi, everybody.
Right. And Chris Alderson, who's the Chief Executive of Construction Health and Safety New Zealand. Chris, you're coming to us from Mystery Location in Central Otago, is that right?
Yes, if I have to say it, it's Wanaka.
No, very nice. So next up, we've got Richie Hepi from Mates in Construction. And how you going, Richie?
Yeah, kia ora, bro. Kia ora, everybody.
And Victoria McArthur, also from Mates in Construction. And you're in Auckland, and you've just heard the news about a bit of a slight extension of Level 3. How you feeling about that one, Victoria?
Oh, pretty ecstatic. Like everybody else up in Auckland, we're pretty excited about another 2 weeks. But kia ora, everybody. Nice to see you all today.
Thanks for that. So we'll go for between 45 minutes and an hour max. We won't keep you too long today, I promise. But look, the reason we're holding this webinar, the CCNZ board just felt that everyone was scratching their heads a lot. There's a lot of interpretation going on at the moment. So they felt the best thing that we could do was to host a webinar on how what people can do about that, and to try and make things a bit clearer for everyone so it's not just a struggle. Also, it's quite polarizing at the moment, all of the talk. I mean, I think no one's feeling particularly good about what's happening, and being locked down or needing to impose new site restrictions. So mental health's really important. So through that, so we thought we'd invite our mates along from Mates Construction to kind of help have a few words around how people can deal with that. Right. So that said, let's get into it. Going to start off today. We've introduced the speakers, but we're going to start off today by really just having a bit of a chat about why we should care as businesses about vaccination and about COVID restrictions, that sort of thing. In terms of the health and safety approach, managing it. And I thought Francois Barton would be a really good person to do that. So I'm going to hand over to you now, Francois. Please take it away.
Thanks, Fraser. And look, just want to send out a word to all our friends and colleagues in Waikato and Auckland and Northland. I can only begin to imagine the challenges of sitting in the state of restriction you are all, and you're doing it on behalf of all of us in terms of trying to get this latest outbreak under something, I won't say control, but at least we can get our arms around it in some way. So just want to send my best wishes to you all. I think the idea of us thinking around what do we need, why is it of interest or why is it of concern is bleedingly obvious, I think. I think the key issue is, I think, from a conversations I'm having with a range of leaders from around the country, is that this is an unprecedented challenge, an unprecedented context as a health risk, both globally and within New Zealand. And when we're confronted with an unprecedented context, we need to be starting to explore a bunch of unprecedented responses. COVID-19 is a public health risk, so hence all the range of public health restrictions. But business doesn't occur in a vacuum. Business occurs within society, within our public arrangement. So whilst there are a range of public health controls in place, businesses still have a primary duty of care to look after the health of their workers and the people they come into contact with. And I think what we're finding at the moment is it's quite a challenging situation for people to be managing both from an organisational perspective, the business's duty of care to the people they engage and employ and work with, as well as the worker's duty of care to look after those, their own actions and impacting those around them. And how we put those in a situation where the risk package that we need to put in place to deal with COVID-19 is it's got a bunch of elements to it, but where vaccination is probably one of the most critical controls. So I think vaccination is probably the hot button issue that people are really trying to get their head around from an interpretation. You know, where is high risk, low risk? And how do we accommodate and acknowledge where people are sitting from a personal choice perspective, as well as where the science lines up? But I think what's useful is if we stop and just step back, you know, good management of risk means you put things in to prevent as well as to help you support recovery. We've got obviously protective equipment. We've got physical work design and ventilation as issues we can all put in place. Testing and hopefully increasingly rapid antigen testing once the current pilot that's about to start gets underway. And these are all really, really important things. But not all risk controls are created equal. And I think vaccines are by far, you know, the most critical tool, but not the sole tool, the most critical tool in that toolkit. And we surveyed our membership, the forum's membership of senior chief executives last week. Out of 115 response, more than half of the chief executives we surveyed were keen to explore some form of mandate for vaccines within their workforces and those they work with. 30% were planning to restrict site access based on vaccination, as well as the same for visitors and for employees. There was a really strong sentiment underpinning the survey that more would if there was clearer government direction and a strong sentiment that a level of sort of public health mandate for employers would be helpful to deal with the issues. Now, that's a really challenging situation. That's an unprecedented response. And it's also one that runs straight into a whole lot of issues around personal belief. So I don't want to remotely underestimate the size of that challenge. But I think the organisations I've been talking to when they've been considering mandate have still been going, the work still needs to be how do we implement and engage in good faith around how do we bring these controls in place over time. So I think it's really important, and I'm really looking forward to hearing from both Chris but also our friends at Mates around, you know, how do we have those conversations meaningfully. But I think the idea of going to some form of mandate, for me, that's most critical is that risk is a function of likelihood and consequence. And if we're not just making a risk assessment now, but we're making a risk sense with the 3, 6 to 8, 12 month context, the likelihood of exposure to COVID-19 and the Delta variant particularly is almost 100%. I mean, the experts are telling us clearly we will all be exposed to it. And the consequence of getting exposed if you're unvaccinated are especially nasty. And if you've got a vaccinated, less so. So in a risk control space, if you've got almost certainty of exposure and a nasty outcome if you're not, it feels really difficult to move past vaccines as a critical control. And the challenge then becomes how do we engage meaningfully with our people and those we work with to do that well. And I think that's where the real work sits, not underestimating how difficult this conversation is, but my sense is listening to business around the country is it's going to be increasingly had in a context where it's going to be almost inevitable that it's going to happen. So how we think about mental health, both as something we need to be sensitive to, but if we get it right, it can be a huge amplifier and enabler of getting better vaccination rates, as well as just helping give people some resilience and somewhere to come and go. So yeah, for my money, I know it might not be where everyone stands on the issue, but I think vaccinations becoming almost a right of access into work is going to be an increasing reality, Fraser. And so I'm really looking forward to hearing my colleagues bring a bunch of other perspectives to what that could look like or why that could be challenging and how we can move forward. So maybe I'll hand back to you.
Great. Well, thanks, Francois. And look, I think it's just important to have that framing of the discussion. Especially, so the Business Leaders Health and Safety Forum, just introduced the organisation briefly. It's got 390-something members now, and that's chief executives of major companies. Some of them are civil construction companies and some of them aren't. But Health and Safety Forum does quite a bit of good policy work. I can see that you've actually put together recently a supporting material about how an organisation or the issues an organisation might think about when building a vaccination policy. One thing I didn't mention at the start of the webinar is there's a chat function throughout this webinar. So if you look at the speech bubbles on the right-hand side, you can use those to ask any questions you might have, and we'll do our best to get back to you with an FAQ. And we'll also drop useful resources in there. So I'm dropping a link in there now to the Vaccine Policy Builder at Business Leaders Health and Safety Forum. So thanks very much, Francois. Great introduction. I'm going to take us on now to James Warren from Dentons, Kensington, Swan, who's going to give us the legal lowdown and high up and everything in between. Please go ahead, James. Sorry, James, I think you might just still be on mute there. Testing? Yeah. I can't hear you, James. You might just need to exit and re-enter using the webinar link. Sorry to all our viewers. James was working just fine a moment ago. So, yeah, if I can get you to exit and re-enter using the link, James, that's probably the best way to go. And in the meantime, I'll just remind everyone that the chat function there, please feel free to use that to ask us questions throughout the webinar. And James should rejoin us in just a couple of moments. Okay, we can see you again, James. Can you try and say a few words? I can hear you now, I think. Wait. No, that might be someone else. Okay. Well, sorry, James. I might just have to get you to exit and re-enter, and we might jump to Chris Alderson and come back to you. Is that okay, James? Great. Thanks. Okay. Well, sorry about it, everyone. We'll jump to Chris while we overcome James's technical issues, and then we'll be right back with you.
Can you hear me, Fraser?
Yes, I can hear you just fine. So what we're going to do is jump on now to something that's relevant to the announcements that were made today. So, Chris, just really good to go a bit into detail about some of the construction site specifics. I know that Construction Health and Safety New Zealand has been very heavily involved in putting together the site protocols, along with CCNZ and the input of industry associations. But we've got a pretty different picture. I mean, would you be able to just give us a bit of a rundown of like where we're at now and where we're heading with this discussion?
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. So maybe if you just flip to the next slide past this one. So obviously we're all thinking about, you know, people talk about living with COVID, what does that look like? We've been working with the construction sector accord to really lay out a roadmap for what the future of construction looks like. And I guess this is a little bit of a request because where we are now, you know, we've had a very strong focus on preventing transmission of COVID-19 between our sites. So our protocols to date, which we've been using over the last 18 months, have been very, very focused on, obviously, not only the industry requirements, but also from a public health point of view, making sure that we do as much as possible to stop COVID passing from person to person. Now, as part of that, obviously, we've had the site protocols. We've had, they've been pretty widely adopted and understood based on the current alert level systems down from 4, 3, 2, 1. But coming with that, and why it's in red, is obviously we've had a lot of work and travel restrictions that have interacted with our COVID protocols, or in some respects, the COVID protocols are integrated with an approach around severe work and travel restrictions to prevent transmission, which obviously is not great from a productivity point of view, from the construction industry. It's not great from a economic point of view. It's going to put a lot of pressure. It's not great from a mental health perspective. I'm sure that Victoria and Richie will back me up here and talk more about that in a minute. And also from a physical health perspective as well. So it does introduce a lot of other risks. We do know that there are, you know, we have had PCR testing, and this has been, you know, widely available, although not really a focus for business up until now, because it's been a national health service that we've been reliant on there. There are a couple of sites that, you know, where they have sort of introduced some PCR testing, mainly obviously in other industries as well, like the ports. It's a regular thing. And of course, you know, we have been promoting vaccines amongst our people, and to date our estimate with MB is that 78% of the construction industry has been vaccinated, which sounds like a good number until you sort of think about the national average, which is higher than that. So we're actually below the national average. And there's a lot of, probably when you think about, you know, who's missing, nationally. You know, we still have to find 635,000 people to get to 90%. And when you look through the age groups about who's missing at the moment, there are a lot of younger workers between, say, 19 and 29. And a lot of those people make up our industry. So we have seen some mandates come through so far for education and for health, but obviously we're also seeing a lot of uncertainty at the moment, particularly from small businesses about what you can and can't do. And that's uncertainty we can't live with, frankly. So look, the roadmap's really saying, look, in the future by December, and a lot earlier than that, we need legal certainty. So we're expecting to see some movement from government to give us some definite rules of the game around navigating all the various legal instruments. So we expect to see that sooner than later, perhaps even as early as the next sort of 2 weeks or so, to have that clarified. That will be good. We are in the future going to be focused more on reducing serious illness and death than preventing transmission. So the focus is going past elimination, and now we're pivoting towards suppression. So what we don't want to do is the health system overrun. As Francois said, you know, we've got a very high chance of coming into contact with COVID. We do want to see, you know, now that we have got vaccination as a strong control, we do want to see lowered work and travel restrictions for high vaccinated workforces. That makes sense. And we want to see site protocols with less restrictions for vaccinated and monitored sites. So, for example, some of the physical distancing requirements we have at the moment, very difficult in some construction and many construction situations as we get more vaccinated and as we start testing more people, which I'll come to, then we can start loosening up some of those as well to actually make it more operationally and economically viable across our industry. So surveillance testing is a new thing. And someone mentioned rapid antigen testing. Also, we call those lateral flow. So a lateral flow test is something that you can administer yourself. I guess the easiest example of that would be, you know, the pregnancy tests you pick up from the chemist that show you a plus or a minus. So it doesn't require a health person. And we need to work out, you know, just what that looks like in terms of a regime across construction. And obviously digital certificates. So it's one thing having vaccinations and testing results, but you know, we need something better than a piece of cardboard to tell people who need to know that information that we have been tested or we have been vaccinated. So a bit further on, so February 22, still not far away, we're still focusing on reducing serious illness and death. We want to see the international borders loosened up for vaccinated and tested workers. We have got a skills shortage. We again want to see those site protocols balanced, and we also want to see more efficient and integrated ways of monitoring vaccine and tests, because what we don't want to do is create a rod for our own backs where we're having to daily mark and monitor everybody going in and out of our sites. That will just create a whole industry and be very inefficient and a big burden, is probably unworkable. So we need to think of better ways, perhaps B2B type, business to business type solutions for that, rather than creating a massive backlog at the gate. I've got a little traffic light down the bottom there. So in case you didn't read the papers in the weekend, there is a new alert level system on its way, and it's going to be called the traffic light system. We don't know too much about it yet, but we're getting clued up on it pretty fast. And what I can tell you is that we will have COVID protocols realigned towards traffic light systems when they come in, potentially in the next 2 to 3 weeks. And what those traffic lights will mean, our understanding at the moment, is that there'll be a red, orange and green, either at a national or at a regional level. A red is obviously around about a 2.5, so there will be some differentiation for red zones for vaccinated versus non-vaccinated sites. There'll be lower restrictions on inter-regional travel, and obviously when we're green, we'll have some international border relief as well. But what I can tell you is that we will keep right on that stuff and make sure that the advice that we're giving out and is available across the Chasm's website through all our partner associations will be in line with what that looks like. Fraser, if you just pop to the next slide. So that's what we think the future is going to look like. As Francois said, what happens when you do come in contact with it? Look, if you haven't been on it already, there is some good guidance on the Chesnes website, chesnes.org/COVID-19. There's a nice little contact classification process there that you can read through that sort of describes the really complex environment we have between positive workers, casual contacts, close contacts, secondary contacts, and what that all means in the work context. What we have found, when we have had secondary contacts and COVID positive people on construction sites over the last couple of weeks, is there is some context that the Ministry of Health will apply. So at the end of the day, their advice trumps everything. And what they're sort of looking for is obviously, you know, just how, what's the context of the potential transmission on your site? And are there any mitigating factors for that? What we're trying to move away from, I guess, is a whole total site closure based as a default to a more nuanced, let's ring fence where we think the highest risk is and deal with that. So to help with that, what we're seeing in the future is obviously sites that can compartmentalise. And what that means is, you know, having bubbles of workers on sites, if it makes sense. So that could either be physically or in time through different shifts. It's why we talk about not having all your trades all arrive at the same time, work in the same small area, because if you do have a situation where COVID has been detected on site, it probably means you will have to close down your whole site because there's no guarantee that there's any separation or any compartmentalisation there. So that's obviously a good thing if you can do it. Understand that it's much easier on larger sites. Surveillance testing will help in the future. So look, if we know you know, who's positive, and if we can get an easy, quick, cheap test, hopefully free, that you know, that will help as well. And the other thing I'd say is, look, cleaning, I've been asked what deep cleaning means. It just means normal household sprays like Dettol and things like that will kill it. You don't need to go out and buy an expensive UV deep cleaning machine or a steam machine, steam cleaning machine or anything like that. Things to watch out for, obviously, really focus on common eating and socialising areas, because that's where it was most likely to spread. Temperature checks using fancy equipment have been proven not really to be effective. So there's been studies out there at the moment saying they're actually more trouble than they're worth, and they don't really help us. So we would not endorse and people investing in that. And just making sure that you know, you're making, you know, you're encouraging people that, you know, if they are contracting positive, that look, they are being paid and they can go and get tested, and they're not frightened of being isolated or quarantined, or that's not a barrier for them, you know, being open and honest about their health situation. So all those good things are things we can do right now. But as this situation emerges over the next couple of weeks, we will absolutely be updating our advice around what this all means. Thanks, Fraser.
No problems, Chris. Yeah, thanks very much for taking us through that. Yeah, we had a couple of questions through that, and I think you might have covered a little bit around it, but around you know, I think there was a question there around what would happen if your work site became a place of interest, and I guess that's one of the areas where you touched on, but it's good to have a little bit of clarity. Is that kind of a case by case basis, really, depending on the site and what the context was?
So look, it depends, again, if you go back to that classification process and that tool that we've put on our website, it depends what kind of interest it is, whether it's actually been somebody on your site that's actually been tested as positive, or whether it's a close contact, casual contact, or a secondary contact. So that's the first thing it depends on. The second thing is when, and broadly, what we've got on that workflow there is typically what we think will happen. Having said that, you know, when the Ministry of Health get involved, and you know, we do obviously say, look, you need to contact the Ministry of Health for these situations, depending on their risk assessment at the time about what's else going on, they could be saying, look, just follow that. Or in some situations, we have seen site close downs because they've adjudged the risk being pretty high. So as we said, look, the things we can do in the future to stop our sites being closed down every time we get a positive. And I would say that if you do a lateral flow test, the chances of getting a false positive are higher. We do know that. And we don't want to get sites closed down every time we get a false positive. So we need to make sure that, you know, we've got a good process around surveillance testing, compartmentalising, being able to clean, making sure that people aren't mixing unnecessarily on our sites. All that stuff helps in not getting your site closed down if you do get a positive.
Mm. Thanks very much for that. Okay, just do a bit of a sound check. Conscious you're back with us, James. Can you say a couple of words? Just see if
can you hear me now, Fraser?
Oh, we can, yes. Okay, that's about good. The added stress on a Monday afternoon.
No, I'm sorry. It's nothing more frustrating for a lawyer than not being heard.
So. Yeah, good on you. Okay, no, thanks for making the effort to join us today and to ride through that little technical hiccup there, but it happens. And we're really glad to have you with us because I think, there's a lot of talk around mandates, around, how we are asking people whether they've been vaccinated or not. Can employers do it? What are the rules around it? So, and I think it'd be really good if you could just go through a little bit of that stuff and clear it up as much as possible at the moment anyway, because I understand that it's a real work in progress. So please take it away, James.
Yeah, I think that's a fair summary, but I will talk to the legal framework and try to provide certainty where I can. I think it's a fair summary to say that employers and business is a long way ahead in terms of what they want to achieve than the legal framework currently allows them to achieve, given the risks and the issues they need to confront when looking at legal justification for either vaccination mandates or testing mandates of some description. And at the outset, I'll say it's largely the same legal framework which applies when we think about mandating vaccinations or requiring staff to test, or indeed seeking information about the vaccination status. We're using similar principles to decide what is justifiable. And the first point I'd make is that a government mandate would provide huge amounts of clarity here, and where the government has mandated vaccinations, there is fairly good certainty about how those work. So we know that there is a mandate in place for borders, border workers, aviation sector. There's a mandate coming for education and healthcare sector, although we've yet to see the details of that. And there's some suggestion that the government might provide further clarity in other areas as well, whether it's a mandate or simply some indication of new rules to provide greater certainty for business. I think that would only be welcomed, because at the moment we have a lot of organisations dealing with a degree of uncertainty and a relatively complex framework to consider as they think about how best to either mandate or not, or otherwise put in place arrangements to deal with the COVID-19 risk. The first point, what is it that will justify some type of mandate? There are really three potential justifications outside of a government mandate. First is if you have explicit agreement with your employees. That might be something which you agree with new staff. And in general, there's not much problem about putting that in place in your new terms of agreement, in terms of employment. And it's possible you might even agree it with existing staff if they agree that's the right way forward, or you provide some sort of incentive for them to do so. The other and probably the most common way in which employers are thinking about this at the moment is identifying a specific health and safety risk which justifies taking the step of mandating vaccinations or mandating testing. And I'll come on to it in a little bit more detail, but the key point here is that we need to identify a particular risk associated with the workplace, which is more than what we simply experience as a member of the community. So it's not for employers necessarily to ensure that every single health risk which individuals face as employees is minimized. They're there to ensure that health and safety at the workplace is maintained and that risks connected with the work or the workplace are minimized or indeed eliminated. Where we're looking at a risk in a workplace which is perhaps no different from the community level of risk, it may be difficult, at least under current law, to justify some sort of mandate. The other, and I think quite important way in which a mandate might be justified is if you have some other business requirement which isn't being imposed, perhaps by a customer or a supplier. And if they put in place rules for those who are contracting with them, either under the terms of existing contracts or possibly as a condition of entry to particular work sites, then it might well be, if that's a contractually binding or other commercial requirement which you need to meet, that you have a basis for putting in place a mandate with your staff as well. It takes it outside that health and safety framework, and it's then just simply a business imperative. And if you have that type of imperative, you'll still have obligations to think about how you deal with a potential mandate, but you have a basis for taking that step when you consider how it is you deploy staff to work for a particular customer or on a particular site. You can take into account those requirements. whatever justification may exist, you need to think about the obligation with your employees to maintain good faith. And that means that when you're proposing to mandate or put in place some particular type of requirements around vaccination, that you should consult with staff. So this is the type of requirement which may impose a detriment upon them. It might lead to some people not being able to work in certain locations or indeed losing their jobs. And if that's the case, it's something which, if it's being introduced as a rule, legally you're required to consult with them and seek their input before mandating that type of policy. I think it's also just, and very obviously in a practical way, good sense to try to engage staff with this conversation and try to reach agreement as far as possible and to take into account particular objections or concerns which they may have. And indeed, that's part of a legal requirement as well. You've got to look at the individual circumstances of each person who might have an objection or a particular concern. So that might be, for example, a medical exemption. And if someone does have a good medical exemption, that could be a basis upon which you agree that you can't impose this requirement. Although, again, it may not get you past certain customer requirements. You might still be thinking about what it is you can actually do with your staff. The other way in which an objection might be raised is if someone might assert that a particular ground or concern they have amounts to a basis for suggesting there's unlawful discrimination if you don't take it into account. And I think in practice, those types of discrimination concerns are probably few and far between. And there's not really any sense that there's a religious basis out there which would justify a refusal to vaccinate. The medical exemptions are actually few and far between, unlikely to amount to discriminatory concerns. Same goes for anything around anti-vaccination beliefs or hesitancy, unlikely to amount to grounds of discrimination. So degree of freedom for employers there to move ahead, so long as they do, in good faith, consider the individual level of concerns. And just think about contractors slightly differently. You don't have the obligation of good faith towards them. You can simply look at the terms of the agreements which you may have or what commercial leverage you have in order to require vaccination or indeed testing of your contractors. It really is down to the terms of the agreement. So that also means that you may not have the same power that you have with your employees simply to tell them what to do. Employers have a power to tell employees anything, to do anything within the scope of their duties and responsibilities. When you come to contractors, it's whatever is within the agreement. When we're thinking about a potential mandate or rules around vaccination and testing, probably the first step is identifying the actual position with staff at the moment. How many are vaccinated? How many are going to vaccinate? What's likely to be the pushback, if any, as we move forward with this process? And I'll say at the outset, I think there's actually little problem or concern around getting this type of information from staff. So the privacy principles under the Privacy Act 2020, they do apply, but they don't prevent you from seeking this information where you have a legitimate business purpose. And a proper business purpose or a legitimate business purpose would be, for example, to be thinking about how you manage your COVID-19 health and safety risk. It could be about how you manage customer and supplier requirements. And it might even be about the potential need to have this information in the future and making sure we have enough time to gather it now and be in a position to deal with those issues when they arise in the future. So those would be good grounds to seek this type of information. You could do so on an initial basis through the use of a survey, and I know that a template survey is being made available by several contractors for consideration and use, and that would be a good starting point. The advantage of a survey is it's a first instance way in which you can gather quick information, possibly on an anonymous basis, so people may feel more able to or more free to say what they actually think. And then from there, you can move to actually seeking individual agreement around what it is about people's individual vaccination status. When you have that type of individual information, it is private personal information, and you need to have regard to the need to keep it confidential and to hold it securely. You can't simply disclose it to customers or to other employees without explicit agreement from the relevant employees. So that's something which you would be looking for at the time that you collect it. There needs to be a description of how you're going to use this information, who you're going to disclose it to, and in what circumstances. So it's worth thinking about it carefully before you get into that process, so you have all the relevant consent or the level of disclosure required in order to use that information as you might need to. And that might even include using that information to identify who it is you need to take formal action in relation to because they're refusing to vaccinate. Employers are entitled to assume that those people who are not willing to cooperate with this type of surveying or providing information about their status are not vaccinated. That's a reasonable position to take. And then, of course, to take action accordingly going forward. So if someone is refusing to disclose that they're vaccinated and you have a mandate in place, that would be a basis for starting a more formal process about dealing with their employment. And of course, if you have an actual agreement from staff that they will provide this type of information, it would be a breach of the agreement for them not to comply. But in general, in the absence of those situations, you're not going to be in a position to discipline people for refusing to reply, but you will be in a position to assume that that means they're not vaccinated. We'll talk a little bit more about conducting risk assessments because it's so key to the way in which you might justify a mandate as a business if you don't have these sorts of customer or supplier demands or indeed a government mandate overlaying the situation. So it's a formal requirement in order to identify the level of health and safety risk. And in order to be able to demonstrate that you've done this process properly, I think it really is important to do it in writing. And to show that you've engaged with staff. So if you're identifying a particular health and safety risk connected to a particular role, but you've spoken to those staff performing that role and you've got their viewpoint on the level of risk and taken that into account in the assessment which you're undertaking. WorkSafe has helpfully set out guidance on the types of issues which you would be examining in order to identify the level of risk. And I've set those out on the slide there. I mean, the key thing is to think about how the work-connected activity or the work-connected interaction is creating a risk which is over and above the level of risk faced in the community. So it might be because the person's role involves them traveling and seeing lots of different people. Perhaps people they need to interact with have a high degree of vulnerability or a high level of infection risk because of the sorts of people, the sorts of roles they're working in themselves. And if you can identify that specifically high level of risk, then I think you're in a good position to take the view that a vaccination may be mandated. If you're identifying a risk which is perhaps no different from anyone else involved in doing anything in the community, you know, for example, going out on the weekend to go walking or office working, which is perhaps no different from the level of risk faced by a number of organisations across the country who are not mandating at the moment, it could be quite difficult and have some risk attached to it to go down that path. So that's something that you'll be weighing up as you go through this assessment exercise. And if you're looking to mandate, you'll be looking to identify those specific risks. So where does that leave us in terms of an overall approach? Well, I think the first thing I would suggest is that plan it out from the outset. Think about what it is you're trying to achieve and why, and put in place a sort of a reasonable timeframe to achieve it. It's one of the difficulties is we don't quite know where we're going to end up at the moment, what government mandates or new rules there might be, how the vaccination certificate is going to work, how the sector and the level of community risk is going to look going forward. But what we can do is identify the principles which we would rely upon as a business to identify the level of health and safety risk or the other business reasons why we would be putting in place a mandate. So if we take the effort or make the effort now to put that down in writing and consult with staff upon those principles, we'll be in a good position either to mandate now when we identify the level of risk needed to justify that or the other business reasons for it, or otherwise to have in place the principles already and lined up to go when the business circumstances or the community risk environment changes and it therefore suggests that we need to take that step. And if we've consulted already and we have in place the policy, that's something which you could turn around and do straight away. And ideally, that policy will also be requiring employees to cooperate with, for example, use of vaccination certificates, the potential future need to comply with changed public health guidance, or there may be construction industry schemes which are put in place to deal with these sorts of issues. And I think you could call out the potential need for those and the need for staff to engage with them from the outset. So it's all about starting the conversation now, putting in place those principles and then being prepared for whatever comes. So being flexible, being fair and trying to have a good conversation with staff, which leads you to a position where you may well be able to mandate. There's risk attached to that now, but it should be getting easier and it may well be the government helps us out shortly in the future. Let's all hope for that. Fraser, I'll finish there.
All right. Well, thanks very much for the James. Much appreciated. And I think really brings us to one of the things that's really just the core of the relationship between an employer and employee, which is good faith. discussion. So, you know, I think if you can understand the people you're working with and understand hear their concerns, then you can work with them. So we have put together a bit of a template for how we can ask about vaccination. So there are Privacy Act requirements that you need to comply with. You need to also have a good reason for collecting the information, explain what it's going to be used for, and store it in a secure way that it can't be accessed by third parties, all that sort of thing. We've put together a bit of a template for that on the back end of the CCNZ website for those that are interested, and we'll also share it with all who have registered for this webinar after the webinar. But I thought it'd be good just to briefly cover off what are people worried about. You know, we hear all about the anti-vaxxers, but like, if we go into it, what are people actually worried about, and how can we have a discussion with those people? I mean, this is a time that's really hard on just about everyone, you know, and the very idea that, you know, an employer might have to lay someone off because they refuse to be vaccinated. I don't know, to me, that's a pretty objectionable thing to happen, you know, and I would imagine that most employers wouldn't want to lay off some of their best staff members because of this, and staff members wouldn't want to be laid off either. So, you know, that's a pretty extreme situation. But I thought it'd be good just to drill into some of the data. I mean, the Ministry of Health conducts research on vaccine sentiment. So the reasons why people are hesitant to be vaccinated. So, I mean, I think at the moment we're at about 86% of the people in New Zealand who are eligible are either vaccinated or have booked in. So what about the rest? I mean, why are people hesitant? I mean, the top one here, I worry there'll be unknown side effects, 37%, and 4% say they don't trust any vaccine whatsoever, ever. So I guess there's a real range of opinion there about why people might be hesitant to be vaccinated, and how they're making that decision as well. And, you know, good faith is really important. If you can have that discussion with your employee and connect them with the authoritative advice, I mean, that's a good thing. I mean, CCNZ, though, for example, we're not a health provider. So if someone's looking for health advice on whether it's right for their situation, they should probably be talking to their doctor. But I mean, that said, a lot of people may not be able to afford a visit to the doctor just to discuss their specific COVID situation and regarding vaccines. So I guess, you know, start of it is that these are some difficult conversations to have in quite polarizing times. People are out there having those discussions, and some of them are from Mates in Construction. So there are our next speakers today. So we've got Victoria McArthur, who's joined us on screen now. And I'm going to hand over to you, Victoria. So if you could just do a bit of an introduction, and then we're going to hear from Richie about some of the work that's going on the ground, having those discussions with real people. So please take it away, Tim.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, kia ora, everybody. And it's really lovely to be here today. Just heard that news, like I say, level 3 again for Auckland. So you can feel those stress levels. And I'm reading some of the questions that are coming through, and just imagine some of the stress that's out there in the industry. And that's really why we're doing what we're doing. So a lot of people have been saying, you know, Mates in Construction, our co-papa is mental health. So what are we doing in this vaccination space, and why have we joined in trying to help the industry with the vaccination program? And the reason that we've done that is we were hearing all of those conversations out there. And what you've got to remember with the vaccination process, it is an individual choice. So it's up to the individual whether they want to vaccinate or not. But in the process of that happening, what we were also seeing was stress levels rising, anxiety rising. And if you're struggling with anxiety or living with depression, there's going to be it's going to be a hard process to actually sift through some of the information that's out there. So we were seeing a lot of misinformation. There's a lot of social media out there, and we wanted to be able to help in that space. Mates in Construction, as you know, is very much evidence-based, research-driven, and we always rely on the experts. So we're always going to refer back to people that can help and help others actually make some of those decisions. So when it was put to us that we'd be able to help in this space, we didn't want to do it on our own. We wanted to work with some trusted parties and get some really good information out there. So we worked with the likes of the Marae, the Manurima Marae, the Waipurira Trust, Ngāti Whātua here in Auckland. And we've been getting some of these organisations out with us on the sites. And Richie will talk to you a little bit more about what's been happening out there on the sites. What we also knew that this industry was really stressed before we went into this lockdown. So we were looking at an industry that was already under a lot of pressure. They were under a lot of stress, and we've seen some of that play out. I remember the Registered Master Builders did a bit of a survey before we went into this lockdown, when I was down at one of their conferences, asking what the stress levels were at, what was actually happening out there in the industry for them. And I think it was about 88% said that stress was a major factor for the residential sector at that time. And only half of those actually had a plan in place to actually be able to do something about mental health on site. And when we started the lockdown, I started to sit in on a few webinars, and I was feeling as well that mental health was actually getting pushed down. We had so many other things to think about with the lockdown. We also had so many other things that had been happening, like shortage of materials, the skills and labor shortages that we were having, the escalating prices, and mental health was starting to get pushed down the agenda. So again, we wanted to bring it forward. So the field officer team have been going onto site to do mental health toolboxes and add on the vaccination myth busting, we're calling it, conversations, to be able to help people and empower them to make some better decisions for themselves. And we're seeing some really, really, really good results. And one of the reasons that we're seeing those results is Richie, that's going to talk to you next, and the rest of my team at Metz and Construction are the faces now in the industry. They're out there. As you know, we are a boots on the ground organization. We work with the guys shoulder to shoulder. And these my team are really well known to the guys and girls out on site. So when they go out and have a bit of a yarn and have a corero with some of the people on the site, they're going to listen to them. They're probably going to listen to them more than they're going to listen to the site supervisor who's telling them to do something. They're going to listen to the whys. So I'm going to hand over to Richie and let him have a little bit of a conversation and about those vulnerable people that are out there that we have been talking to, those people that are already sitting very highly, being represented very highly in our suicide demographic, that we've been able to work with and being able to support them. So I'll hand over to you, Richie, and you can have a bit of a talk. And if you need to refer back to me, that's cool.
Cool. Thanks, Vic, and thanks, Fraser. Kia ora, everybody. So I guess what we are as field officers is the tangible side of this vaccination. So we can get on site and have these conversations with our brothers and our sisters who are doing it hard in the trenches, basically. Now, you'd be wondering why some of these, there's a lot of resistance within our construction industry with certain groups, especially Māori. And being Māori, it's important for me to be able to get out there. And Slade's also Māori, so we try and tag team together so that we can, one, we've got to look after our people's mental wellness. And you also got to realise too, you know, we've been locked down for a long time. And so people are going through some stress. And if somebody's mental wellness is not on point, they're going to make poor decisions. And if they're listening to, you know, somebody that's you know, anti-vaccination, they could be listening to, you know, why they're anti, you know. And there's all these myths that go around, et cetera, you know, going to turn into a magnet, you know, again, a chip injected in you, all this sort of rubbish, you know. And Slade and I and the rest of the field officers, we go in there to dispel those myths. And it's quite simple as this, is that, one, we're vaccinated. And we're vaccinated because we believe in it. Like Vic says, we're evidence-driven. And we do our research. We've done our due diligence. We know this stuff. And the fact is, whether it's mental health, suicide prevention, or vaccinations, you know, we do our research. We make sure that we know this stuff. So we're not going onto a site and talking a lot of kaka to guys, and they'll listen to us. And the reason why they listen is because we're strong. We're strong advocates, you know. And the other thing is what we do is that we have our team, our vaccination team from Manurewa Marae, who put themselves at risk to come onto site. And so they're there, ready. We go in, we do our toolbox. And sometimes it's good because we might have one of the practitioners there. We might have a doctor or a nurse who can actually come in and join us in that toolbox and talk about the vaccination and what COVID does to you and how the vaccination actually fights that. And so that's given us, you know, authenticity, as well as we're given authenticity as well, because why? We're vaccinated. And, you know, just the other day I went out and got my a test done. So I'll make sure that when I go onto a site, yes, I've got my vaccination card, and yes, I've just been I've been tested, and I'll get another test next week to make sure that it's up to date. And that's what we need to do. And if we're talking to our guys about this and saying, this is what we're doing to keep ourselves safe, because what it is we're saying is that the vaccination is part of our PPE now. So if you're wearing PPE to keep yourself safer, whether it's a high vis, whether it's a hard hat or hard boots, you know, the vaccination is going to keep us safe. And I know that for a reason, I know that for a fact, because we know that people that have been vaccinated and that have contracted COVID have actually recovered and recovered quickly. That's what research tells us, man. And so we've got to be out there talking to our guys like this and letting them know that, you know, not to listen to what you hear from Facebook or TikTok or Twitter, you know. And the other thing is, too, is our young Māori are resistant. And it's only be, and the thing with being, our young Māori being resistant is that they take this stuff home, because a lot of our kids, they actually live with their grandparents, and they'll be going home telling their grandparents, don't get vaccinated, Nan, don't get vaccinated, Koko, because of this and because of that. I know this for a fact, because this is happening in my family, and I've had to go and have this, these strong conversations with them and say, you know, don't listen to them and tell them why. But also, you know, if we know our stuff, in which we do through our research, we're able to then take them through and walk them through the processes. And when we walk them through that process, it's like they look at you and go, oh, well, wouldn't they just tell us that? And this is it. The stuff has been made too hard for our people to understand. It has to be done in layman's terms. And that's why myself, Slade, and our other field officers, that's why we make a difference. And that's why people will listen to us, is because we do it in layman's terms. And we talk about the stuff as though, hey, this is PPE for you, man. You know, if we don't get 95% vaccinated, you know, we're not going to go back out, you know, and get on with life. We're going to be stuck in lockdown. And now we're stuck for another 2 weeks. And so tomorrow I'm going out to do a vaccination run with our team. And I'll be saying exactly that. You know, we're locked down for another 2 weeks. So if you want us to get out of this, get vaccinated. You know, and we asked the hard questions. Who's being vaccinated? Who has not been vaccinated? And there's only a certain amount of people that have been exempt from vaccinations. We know that through research and through what we've been told. Okay. And so if you're not one of those people, why aren't you getting vaccinated? And that's, these are the questions that we ask, you know, because I want to get back out there. Slade wants to get back. Vic wants to get back out there. We all want to get back out there. We've had to cancel everything from October right through to next year. So we can't get out and deliver training to our people, and that's impacting on us. So so we have to be real, and we have to be staunch about this stuff, but we also have to be kind and in the way where we explain it so people can understand. And you've got to remember that most of the guys that we talk to, guys and girls that we talk to, they're doing 12-hour shifts 6 days a week, so they may not see the stuff that we see, so they're not clued up. Okay, so it's important for us to have the correct information and go out there and do it in a way where they are going to put their hand up to be vaccinated. And I'll give you an example. Last week we were on a site and was 100 workers, and I asked the question, you know, out of you guys, how many are vaccinated? Only half put up their hands. So we went through that conversation. Now, at the end, 12 of those people actually got vaccinated. Now, half of those 12 got vaccinated because of our conversation, okay? And so this works. It does work. But obviously, we needed to work a lot more, because I'm going crazy, man.
Thanks, Richie. Thanks. And look, the other thing that we have to remember, those vulnerable communities that Richie's talking about, the young people, our rangatahi that are out there that haven't vaccinated, they're under a lot of influence at the moment. We need to look after them. So we need to have the conversations. And it is, like Richie says, making it really simple. I've listened to the webinar today. It's absolutely fantastic. Some great information coming out. But we need to disseminate this down to a site level so that the guys and the girls on site actually really understand why they need to do this and really encourage them to do this in a kind way. So one more plug before you go to questions. We're on, if anybody wants to see the guys out doing the mahi, they're on 7 sharp tonight, Richie and Slade and James from my team. We're interviewed by Seven Sharp. So if you tune in tonight, you'll see them out on site.
Magic. Thanks very much. And also, just before we go to the more general questions, I think it's really important, safe discussion. So how does someone ask a question that they might have without being labelled an anti-vaxxer and kind of set up to do that? You know, if they've got all the questions they want to have answered, how do you make it safe for them to kind of have that conversation with you?
Do you want to answer that, Richie? Because you have those conversations.
Oh, sorry. Was that for us? Oh, sorry. Yeah.
He said, how do you have the conversation? And so that they're not labelled an anti-vaxxer. If they're a bit hesitant, how do you have that conversation?
Again, it comes down to example. And if we set the example, you know, and we give them the correct information, it's about making informed decisions. And that's why it's important that we have a group like Manerewa Marae with the Shot Cuz bus come on with us. So if we've got a nurse or a doctor that can accompany us and do the toolbox with us, and when somebody says, yeah, you know, I don't really know about this, all we're doing is giving them the correct information, you know, and then they'll give them a website to go to, you know, follow this information. And that's all it is. It's giving them the correct information so that they can make, you know, informed decisions. Because if somebody doesn't want to get vaxxed, cool. Why aren't you getting vaxxed? If somebody doesn't want to get vaxxed and has the correct information, then why? You can ask yourself why. And so these are the questions that I'm asking too. I'll ask the person straight up, why don't you want to get vaxxed? And if it's a not a very good answer, then I'm going to try and persuade them, really, really persuade them, they need to get vaccinated.
Nicely.
Thanks for that. And so I'll just welcome our other presenters back. I think Chris might have had to take off, so sorry about that. But I wanted to say to everyone that's attending here, do ask us questions using the webinar chat function. We'll make a recording of this webinar available afterwards. If we've got the questions as well and we don't get time, I think, you know, we've gone quite a long webinar so far, but we'll do our best to answer your questions now. And if we can't get to them, we'll do our best to answer them in an FAQ document, which we'll follow up after this webinar. So one of the ones that's been asked a couple of times was around human rights and, you know, what people have the rights to be able to do or not. I think in terms of, like, the specifics, the Human Rights Commission does have some information on that I'll link to just in the chat function there. But, I mean, James, perhaps that's a good one for you in terms of human rights. Is getting a COVID-19 vaccine mandatory is kind of a simple way to put it. I mean, you know, there's a mandate here, but, you know, if it's a business making a mandate rather than like a blanket government mandate, how does that work?
Yep. So the Human Rights Act is potentially relevant. It sets out a number of grounds of protective characteristics like your age or your ethnicity, but it doesn't directly apply to the sorts of considerations which we're normally considering when we think about mandates. So it's not normal that there will be a discrimination issue or angle. Sometimes people also talk about the Bill of Rights, so the New Zealand Bill of Rights, and that does contain a provision which basically confirms that individuals have the right themselves to decide what medical treatment that they receive. And that does have direct application to the public sector, but not to the private sector. Having said all of that, there is some case law about the government mandates themselves and the legislation which has been used there. And that at the High Court level has confirmed that legislation does not infringe someone's human rights. And the little bit of case law we have about a potential employer mandate has confirmed that it's unlikely to be an infringement of human rights also if there are good grounds on a health and safety basis or otherwise to take that step. So it is something to think about carefully, but unlikely to be relevant in most situations.
Yeah, and I guess that's a situation to be avoided, really, isn't it? If you're getting to that stage, then it's then you probably there's an obligation to think through the other options for that person as well, rather than sort of dismissing them as well, isn't there?
Yeah, there's certainly that's that sort of good faith obligation when you're dealing with your employees to think carefully about what other alternatives there might be before you take the step of potentially terminating their employment or even simply removing them from the work site if that's going to have an impact upon their income and how you deal with that person. But in the end, if there aren't any good alternatives and you've thought carefully about them and you've talked with the individual about the situation, not being able to identify a suitable alternative, you may well be justified to take that step. I mean, you may not want to, but that might be where you end up if there's no other alternative.
Right. Look, and I just add freedom of association, freedom of movement are also two rights protected by the Bill of Rights. And right now, our friends in Auckland and Northland and Waikato are having those severely constrained for good reason. And I think when the ability to relax those is dependent on us hitting a vaccination rate, which is another, is we're in a situation where we have a bunch of, right, this is an extraordinary situation demanding extraordinary responses. And I think it's always important that we can balance these rights. We can see them in context.
Yeah, interesting. So we've actually come up on 5:15 now, which I can't believe because it seems like it's gone by in a couple of minutes. But I think we should try and go through a couple of other questions here. So if we got to a space through risk assessment that we decided to mandate testing on a regular basis, would this be reasonable or could it be considered discrimination? Assuming the engagement had taken place beforehand.
Yeah, I mean, if you've identified a good basis for that on the sorts of grounds which we were talking about earlier, I think that's absolutely fine. That might well be, as we've seen for some of the proposed mandates in the education sector, that might well be a basis for dealing with the interim situation while people are not vaccinated. And I don't see any reason why it would be unreasonable if you've identified a high level of risk and you want to try to minimise it.
Yeah, so I guess a comparable, is that comparable to drug testing, for example, in terms of health and safety outcomes, do you think?
Or? Yeah, again, a similar framework applies. So if you're thinking about drug testing, often it is about identifying that particular sensitivity or safety issue connected to drugs in the workplace. And obviously those are fairly straightforward in the construction sector, particularly when people are dealing with heavy machinery, et cetera. It is the same type of analysis which you need to perform when you're thinking about the COVID-19 risk as well. How do we identify that risk as a risk to the workplace? But in basic terms, I think you can test if you've identified that level of risk which you want to minimise.
Yep, great. So question for mates, and in fact, something pretty cool came through. So someone messaged through thanking Richie because they were vaccinated at Mangere Marae and had a great experience there. So someone actually put that in the chat function there, Richie, so good on you. I guess a couple of questions there. Are there any video resources for teams that Mates has provided around the vaccine conversation? Or
So the vaccine conversation, we've just centered it around some of that myth-busting stuff, the misinformation that's been out there. And Richie took part in a Chazens piece that they recorded with Dr. Tom Mulholland. Now, that's quite a good little resource if you want to know some of the questions that are being asked. And that's how we frame it. But like I said when I started, make sure you do the mental health toolbox. Make sure you're adding that into your site conversations, because I think it's being missed a lot at the moment. And then it'll naturally flow into this myth-busting. You know, you can do some of that with it. So you start to listen to the anxieties that are out there and start the group having a conversation rather than you telling people that you're actually getting them to talk to each other. There's nothing like more like a bit of peer pressure to actually get people to actually, you know, you don't have to do it, but the guys will do it and the girls will do it amongst themselves. So the mental health toolbox, we've got a resource for that on our website showing you how to actually start that conversation around mental health, which you can download from the site. And then just naturally go into that conversation about the vaccination. And like Richie's very good at doing, he steps back and lets them have that conversation between themselves.
Mm. And just the other thing with that Dr. Mulholland, that webinar that we did, if you can have a look at that, it's such a good tool. Now, if you're like me, I didn't like going to school. So, you know, I went to school to eat my lunch and it's normally somebody else's. And if you know, if you can't get my attention for 5 seconds, I'm looking for stars, man. I'm looking, you know, out the window, etc. Well, I tell you what, that the explanation that he gave us, and it was so good, you know, it was just on point, just with pictures and how it worked, and he went step by step in a way that a 5-year-old could understand it, man. And so this is the stuff that we've got to get out to our kids. This is the stuff that we have to get out to our Māori whānau, especially our older whānau who you know, didn't have a good education and, you know, are scared of that sort of stuff, because that was really great. And if I can you know, stay, you know, in the game for an hour, boom, you're winning.
Well, on that note, we have stayed in the game for an hour and it's after five. I might just give you a few final words, if you could, Francois, because I'm conscious that you've joined us for a reason. Do you want to give us a little bit of a wrap and then we can take off?
Look, I just want to fully endorse, I guess, the insights of the whole group. You know, I think the point that Richie and Vic make is hugely important, that, you know, people's sense of confidence and psychological safety is going to be whether their minds are open or closed to the ideas. And if the vaccine is scary for people, we need to be able to talk to them and engage them on their own terms. I think my final thought would be, we just need to realize, I think, the consequences as a country of us not getting to a certain vaccination rate is keeping us all in lockdown. And there's going to be some people that aren't going to want to go there for a whole bunch of reasons. And I think the imperative and the opportunity for us to be able to have these conversations in a space where the outcome's going to be maybe required, I think, is inevitable. And I think we need to start thinking around how do we also, you know, get ready for that world too. So look, I think, like I say, unprecedented context is going to demand, I think, of all of us some ongoing unprecedented responses. So I think we just need to stay the course.
Yeah. Okay. And we did have a question about sharing the presentation that Richie was talking about.
I just popped it up there, Fraser. It's up there. Yeah. So it's the Chazen's resource there. Yeah, that's right. The one.
So you did. Yeah. Okay. Excellent. Well, thanks very much to all our speakers and to all those who have attended. Please, I encourage everyone just to get out there and ask us questions. Like, if you've got questions, just to send them through, whether it's by email, whether it's through the chat function. We'll do our best to get the answers for you. And I enjoyed it. What I took out of this is that actually two-way conversation is really important as well. So what you were saying there, Victoria, about you know, being able to, doing the mental health aspect first and then being able to figure out how to support your team through this discussion while keeping the mental health front of mind. Thanks, everyone. Thanks, James Warren from Dentons, Kensington, Swan, Francois Barton, Business Leaders Health and Safety Forum, Richie Hepi from Mates in Construction, and Victoria McArthur from Mates in Construction, and Chris Alderson from Construction Health and Safety New Zealand.
Thanks, Fraser.
On behalf of you all, goodbye.
Good afternoon, everyone. Bye.
Bye.